My name is Robert John Langdon, and you're watching my video channel. This video cast is one of my 10-minute shorts, which looks at sites around Britain using LiDAR. In a strange sense, this is my version of landscape archaeology for the 21st century. I hope you enjoy. This week, we look at Avebury Stone Circle, a little bit like Stonehenge. The way to examine this site is to look at the surrounding areas and the landscape. What I've done is split this into three sections, and this is phase one, which we should concentrate at Windmill Hill. Now, Windmill Hill is a very interesting site because it's somewhat northwest of the main site of Avebury, but if we see it, it's actually on the highest aspect of the landscape. Now, if we put in the Neolithic water levels at the time, we see it's become an island, which makes it even more interesting. If we now zoom into the site, we're going to give it a bit of a tilt to make it much more interesting to look at. And then we're going to give it a bit of a look around. So we're going to look around while I explain Windmill Hill and what the archaeologists make of it, really. After the Great Melt of the last ice age, this area would have been almost flooded at the start of the Mesolithic period, about 10,000 BCE. The only part of Avebury above this initial water level would have been Windmill Hill. This site shows evidence of occupation. It is what archaeologists call a Causewayed enclosure, as they incorrectly imagine that the moats that built to accommodate ships and boats were in fact dry ditches to contain cattle, would you believe? So, let's have a closer look at this, shall we? This is Windmill Hill. Now, the first thing you should observe is location. If you're going to build a site, surely you would have built it in the middle of the island, and archaeologists don't believe it was an island. This is, if it was a hillside, then you would have built it on top of the hill rather than on one edge, which doesn't make any sense. As we spin around, you see this more clearly. Now, the fascinating aspect of this is that one of these ditches dips into what would have been the River Kennet in the Mesolithic period. When we've looked at other sites such as Old Sarum, we actually found that there are very, very clear dikes that go from the inner ring to the outer ring. But what you do see very clearly is where they've actually positioned this Causeway enclosure, as they call it. This gives you a better idea of the original depth of the ditches. This is all being ploughed out, left. So we only got a ghost of the image as it was. But clearly, this is a lot different to what the archaeologists imagine is something for cattle. The construction of this kind of site used for cattle, to be honest, is complete nonsense. If you think about it, as the time, the effort, the organisation, and the workforce required to dig these ditches for some cows is, I find, totally bizarre. You know, at the end of the day, wood was free. Build a fence. It's far, far quicker. This is 30 times more work than building a fence. And at the end of the day, why would you want, you know, 3 rigs? If it's to corral some cows, that's great. Put it that way and you know, fence it off in the middle. It's much. Why would you do a concentric circle site for some cows? And sadly, this is archaeology today. It's nonsense. It doesn't make any sense. Any rational person would look at this and go, well, obviously, there must have been method in their madness. Look, you know, you've spent, you know, thousands of man hours building something and you're going to put some cows in it. You know, if a ditch was an effective way of keeping cows in, you would have farmers with their JCBs, which is somewhat quicker than digging it by hand, knocking out ditches all around their farms rather than building fences, which is, you know, it's just a nonsense. But that's archaeology today. You know, what do I know? I'm an idiot, according to them. So this was phase one. Back to reality rather than the archaeological bubble. This was phase one. It's a causeway enclosure. And, you know, the most fascinating aspect. I don't call them causeway enclosures because it's a nonsense. I call them concentric circle sites. And I do that because one of the earliest writers in history talk about them, would you believe? You know, someone from 300 BCE talk about concentric circle sites. And that guy was Plato. Plato described a city with concentric circles. It's amazing that you got someone in history who actually writes about concentric circle sites. Now, it's, you know, this is over 2,500 years ago. Much closer to the time where obviously these sites existed. So one would imagine that they had a better idea of why they were constructed then today. But the most amazing aspect of, you know, Plato's work and concentric circle sites is that he dates them as 9,000 years before his present. So then 9,000 BCE we're talking about. Now, no one in the past ever imagined that these sites could exist, but they have existed. And they're here now. They're in Britain. They're in the Northern Hemisphere. They're probably under Doggerland, where these people actually who originated these sites came from. And an amazing aspect of Plato's work is that he talks about a civilization who drowned under, you know, the first of climate change, I suppose, the way to put it, by rising sea levels. And that was 9,000 years ago. That's when it started, at least. And these sites are dated back to then. Now, the archaeologists would tell you, oh, no, they're only 3,000 BCE, not 9,000. They're only 5,000 years old, not 10,000 years old. And that's because, at the end of the day, they date, and if we put this on hold again, they go and date these sites by what they find in this ditch. Now, to be honest, that's probably what I would call bad science. And they're bad science because at the end of the day, you cannot date that site by what's in that ditch. So, back to our little display. We have Windmill Hill. It's made to touch the River Kennet, because you would sail your boat to this river, in you go, on the inner circle. You can park it there. I would imagine that something like here, you can then take your boat to the inner circle. Perhaps, I see it more like a car park. Everybody goes to Sunday markets, don't they? Think of it more, your boat is your modern day car. You take it along the river, which is the highway, and you want to sell your goods at the back of your Sunday market. So you park your car in a car park as close to the centre as possible. You know, if you got there late, you have to come to the end. If you got there early, you get in the centre, wherever you got the bigger footfall. So you go there, you park your car, you open your boot, and you sell your goods. Do you think people in the past didn't do something similar? They didn't have a car, clearly, but they had a boat. You take your boat full of your goods, you come into this site, you take your, bring your boat in from the river. If you're late, you have to park around the end. If you're early, you can go to one of the inner circles if you're really, really early and you've got lots of things to sell. But perhaps you're selling food. You know, we know that food was brought from as far as Scotland into Big Mead. We know that. It's a fact. You know, it's something archaeologists don't like to admit. But they're mystified. How the hell do you get a cow from Scotland to Big Mead if you don't have a boat? It's, you know, the idea they bring this by car is absolute nonsense. You wouldn't even know where Big Mead is from Scotland. You know, have they got GPS or the greatest signposts in the world? I don't think so. But you can follow a river, and rivers usually lead down to places like this. And we'll have a look with phase two, how they got to places like this in the most obvious way. So you bring your boat in. If you're early, you get into the centre. If you're selling food particularly, you get into the centre. There you go. You park your boat on the banks and people will come here. Perhaps the people with their wares take this inner circle and this outer circle. And people that are visiting use the outer circle. You know, at the end of the day, if you bring your boat, you can always park it on the edge and walk up. Yeah. And you could beach it on these beaches and just walk across, you know, we've got a footpath that may be tens of thousands of years old. You know, you could park, beach it there, walk up, do some trading, go back to your boat, go back home. Phase one of Windmill Hill. Piece of cake if you've got half a brain. Well, that's all we've got time for this week. Tune in next week for another edition of Langdon Investigates, where we look at another ancient site. Until then, subscribe below to make sure you're informed when new videos come on the video channel. Until then, thank you for watching.